Hello and welcome to Das Nostalgia. I'm Anatoly and today I'm going to take you to the year 1993. While PC game market was getting even bigger than before with tons of retail and shareware releases, PC gaming didn't yet have a mascot with the magnitude of an Italian plumber or a blue hedgehog. That's when a small company from Belgium called Copysoft decided to take their shot. In total, they released 6 games featuring Scunny Hardnut, an anthropomorphic jacket-wearing squirrel who happens to be a secret agent. Let's take a look at them. First up is Desert Raid. The story is that the evil dictator Sadman Insane is building weapons of mass destruction, and the government had no better plan than to send a squirrel in a biplane to take care of that. Oh, also, may the force be with you. The game itself is a primitive horizontal scrolling shooter. Shoot things ahead of you, avoid hitting obstacles, and bomb things on the ground. There are, however, a few issues that become apparent right from the beginning. First, just listen to the music. This short loop of awfulness is the only music that's going to accompany you throughout the entirety of the game. Next is controls. They're super sensitive. It's hard to dodge uncommon things or aim properly. Then it's, well, pretty much the rest of the game. The level design is frustrating and also incredibly boring. It's a real test of patience to even get to the end of the first level. Which, by the way, is the only level in the shareware version of the game, with the full version offering only 5 more levels. Next game is Lost in Space. In this game, Scunny is sent to the moon in order to retrieve some satellite dishes and scientists that were kidnapped by some green aliens. This time, Copysoft developers decided, true to their name, to just flat out copy the arcade classic Moon Patrol, only they couldn't even manage to do that right. Listen to what this game sounds like. You guessed it, that's what it's gonna be for the rest of the game. Everything else seems to be broken as well, from the way your bullets fly to how most of the time it's impossible to execute a high jump and Scunny ends up plummeting to his doom. The shareware version of this game also had only one level, with further 5 offered in the registered version. By the way, registering Lost in Space and Desert Raid cost $20 each. Now let's move on to the first Copysoft platformer game, Scunny and Rosie, Back to the Forest. I don't think anyone cares what the story is in this game, so let's just discuss the gameplay. Here, the developers clearly decided to rip off Sonic the Hedgehog, although, unlike Sonic, Scunny accelerates almost instantly, making it nearly impossible to not run into enemies, which is kind of okay, as foot pickups, this game's equivalent of Sonic's rings, are plentiful. Scunny's health also acts as a timer and gradually decreases. At the end of each level, you'll find a super health nut, which gives Scunny superpowers. Then you need to find giant toads and destroy them before timer runs out. Oh, and what does this game sound like? Yeah. The shareware version offered 2 levels, and the full version with 10 levels was available for $30, which by the way is around $50 today. And there is a feature to play as Rosie instead of Scunny. As annoying as this game is, it's probably the least painful Copysoft platformer. Next game is called Save Our Pizzas. An evil chef has brainwashed all the Italian pizza makers into forgetting how to make pizza, and now people of Italy can only get pizza in his chain, where it's made from old shoes and plastic vegetables. Italian government comes up with a solution, to send Scunny back in time to ancient Rome to retrieve the original pizza recipe. But the evil chef also travels back in time and tells the Emperor Bigastitus? Oh, I don't even care anymore. Anyway, here's Scunny in ancient Rome. This time his Sonic-like running ability has been taken away, thankfully. Now Skani is fighting against Roman soldiers. Again, this game has a myriad of issues. If Skani runs into an enemy, he bounces back, which doesn't go well with many pits and one-hit death traps. Awful collision detection also often works against you when you're trying to stomp on an enemy. Skani can use bombs as weapons, but they take a long time to explode and have a very limited range. Coins need to be collected in order to proceed further in each level, but they can be hidden or even worse. They can be dropped by moving enemies and lost. Once again, two levels are available in the shareware, with 8 more included in the registered version that could be purchased for $30. An interesting thing that connects all 4 Skani games from 1993 is that each story description ends with a bit about how Skani is a squirrel who likes sticky nut puddings, and that he always dreamed about being in a computer game, but no company would make his dream come true. That's when he hired a programmer and an artist who called themselves Copysoft, who, in order to put Skani into a computer, shrunk him by washing him in a washing machine for days until he was small enough to be put in a microchip. So when you're playing the game on your computer and it is late at night and you hear a small squeaky voice coming from your PC, just think it may be Skani. No doubt crying for help. Now let's fast forward to 1994, when another Skani platformer appeared. Wild West. After Skani ends his adventures in ancient Rome, he jumps back into his time machine, but instead of finding himself back in the early 90s, he's transported into the time of American Frontier. It turns out, Skani's mother changed the settings to transport Skani to the year 1909, so Skani could find all the sheep that were stolen from Skani's parents' farm. This is how the worst Skani platformer starts. This time he fights cowboys and Indians with his water pistol. All the issues of Save Our Pizzas are back, with an addition of a few new ones. First, the enemies now respawn. Second, Skani can now pick up wooden crates that can later be put back down in order for him to jump over a high obstacle. He can only carry one crate at a time. The levels are built in a way that make you backtrack in order to find these crates, which can be hidden in a way that secret bonuses would be hidden in a normal game. Not only crates are hidden in that way, but also sheep, of which you have to collect every single one to be able to finish a level. This game is insanely hard. Pretty much every collision with an enemy is guaranteed to leave you with almost no health. Combine this with many deadly pits and one-hit death traps, and well, you see what I'm trying to say. Surprisingly, the music has improved a lot from the previous games. The tune you're hearing right now is the only tune in the game, but it's so much more pleasant than the nightmare that came before. Copysoft took out the terrifying story of Skani being put inside of a computer out of this game, and surprisingly lowered the price of the registered version to $20. Next came a somewhat special game, Skani Kart. Released in 1994, Skani Kart is an arcade racing game, very much inspired by Mario Kart, where Skani and other animals compete in a race. But Anatoly, you say, this looks suspiciously like Apogee's shareware classic Wacky Wheels. Well, there is a very simple explanation for that. The people behind that shareware classic worked for Copysoft, and originally Copysoft was going to publish Wacky Kart, as it was then called, although no business agreement was made. Eventually, the developers went to Apogee, but Copysoft took their unfinished prototype and built Skani Kart using its source code. As a result, there are quite a few differences. First one is controls. Not only they're weirdly positioned on the keyboard and you can't remap them, but there is no manual brake. That is a major issue for a game of this type, as making sharp turns becomes extremely difficult. Second is the lack of overall polish. This game is full of all kinds of bugs, and there is no balance. There is no difficulty curve, and some of the later tracks can be easier than the ones before them. There is also this weird dissonance with environments, like these mountains during their European challenge. Or this, guess what country this is supposed to be? Of course, it's Australia. There are many other differences between this game and Wacky Wheels, but really the most important one is the frame rate. This game's normal frame rate is lower, and it's really hard on the eyes. The graphics and music are a big improvement over other Copysoft games, but this still isn't a game that's fun to play. Both Wacky Wheels and Scunny Card were released around the same time, and here's even a review of both of them in the same article in the German magazine. Copysoft were accused of stealing, but Apogee didn't take any legal action, and both games continued to be commercially available. Playing Scunny Card today only makes you realize how much additional testing, fine-tuning, and work went into Wacky Wheels after the developers joined Apogee, and how they got an enjoyable game because of that in the end. Despite being mostly terrible, Scunny Games ended up becoming somewhat of a staple of shovelware CDs, BBSs, and internet game download websites. They even got reviewed in magazines and showed up on cover discs. Copysoft seemed to have an office that accepted payments for Scunny Games in just about every major part of the planet. In 1995, a new Scunny game appeared called Scunny Special Edition. This time around it was more of a proper game, kind of a budget knockoff of Donkey Kong Country, and it deserves its own review someday. But Scunny's story doesn't end there. Unlike many shareware games from the early 90s, Scunny games continue to be available for purchase. Copysoft are still around, and you can buy these games right now on copysoft.com. They're sold for $5 a piece or a whole pack for $20. But don't run out to buy them just yet. As of the moment when I'm recording this, Copysoft's website has a serious flaw. You see, when you go to a page for each game, you're given an option to download the shareware version. But clicking on a screenshot from the game instead will give you a download of a full registered version. That is true for every game except for Scunny Card. But if you want to grab a full version of that as well, you can just strip the name of the zip file from the link to any other game, and you'll get a folder where full versions of the games are stored. So if you really want these games, you know where to find them, although honestly I doubt many of you will make it past the levels included in the shareware versions in the first place. So do I think these games are worth playing? Absolutely not. Why am I reviewing them? Because over the years many people have encountered these games and attempted to play them. Many people remember these games. No doubt there might be even a few out there who like them, probably because they had a computer but no better games to play on it. If you're one of these people, please leave me a comment. And this is it for this episode of Das Nostalgia. Thank you for watching. See you next time. And a big shout out goes out to these awesome DOS enthusiasts, without whom this episode of DOS Nostalgia would not be possible. If you enjoyed this video, please like this video, subscribe to my channel, and consider supporting DOS Nostalgia on Patreon to see more videos like this one in the future. Thank you again.